many faces of women book reading and discussion, while contemporary literature has a pattern of stereotyping women, whereas if you look at the history of Indian literature, women have always had powerful roles to play. So in today's session, we hope to have a variety of opinions on this subject, considering the combination of panelists we have with us. So let me take the privilege to invite them on stage, Ms. Anjum Hassan, Ms. Anuja Chandramouli, Mr. Chandrahas Chaudhary, and Ms. Shiny Anthony. Can we have a round of applause for all of them? Ms. Anjum Hassan is a poet and novelist. Her first collection of poems, Street on the Hill, came out in 2006. Her latest work, The Cosmopolitan, a novel, explores the dilemmas of the new and urban India as thousands make a migration from small cities to the cosmopolis. It has also received reviews. She's currently books editor at the Caravan magazine as well. Can we have her on dice, please? Ms. Anuja Chandramouli is a best-selling Indian author and New Age Indian classicist. Her highly acclaimed debut novel, Arjuna, Saga of a Pandava Warrior Prince, was named in a poll conducted by Amazon India as one of the top 5 books in the Indian writing category for the year 2013. She's also authored the best-selling novel, Kamadeva, The God of Desire. Her third book, Shakti, The Divine Feminine, is a definitive work on the mother goddess. And yes, she also calls herself a hopeless blogger. Well, Mr. Chandrahas Chaudhary is a novelist and columnist. His novel Arzi, the Dwarf, was shortlisted for the 2010 Commonwealth First Book Award and selected by World Literature Today as one of 60 essential works of modern Indian literature in English. And it was also published in German and Spanish edition. He's edited an anthology of Indian literature called India, A Traveler's Literary Companion, and since 2011 has also been the fiction and poetry editor of the monthly magazine, The Caravan. And we have also with us Ms. Shiny Anthony. She's written 4 short story collections, The Orphanage for Words, Barefoot and Pregnancy, Ends on a Sunday Afternoon, Planet Polygamous, and the novels When Mira Went Forth and Multiplied, and Cardamom Kisses. Interesting titles, all of them, I would say. Co-founder of the Bangalore Literature Festival and director of the Bangalore Business Literature Festival, she won the Commonwealth Short Story Asia Region Prize in 2003 for her story, A Dog's Death. Her latest work is an Amar Chitra Katha novel, A Kingdom for His Love. Can we have all of them on dais with a round of applause, please? Many faces of women. We also have a man with us, though. Yeah. I would request Ms. Anthony to please take the session forward. No? Okay. All right. I would request Ms. Anuja Chandramouli to take the session forward from here. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Hope you enjoyed your lunch, and I really hope you're not feeling too sleepy. Hope so. So when Shampa first told me about this topic, the many faces of women, I was reminded of a rather unpleasant incident. Somebody I knew told somebody else I know, Anuja has another face and it's very ugly. And of course, I was very hurt when I heard that, and I'm a drama queen, so I ran around saying, how could she say something so mean about me and things like that. And then later, when I calmed down, I realized it's true. I have many, many, many faces. And they're not very pleasant to look upon. It's an ugly truth which makes you uncomfortable. But the thing is, this condition is not exclusive to only me. It applies to most women and more than a few men. It's not like men show the same face to their wife, their mother, their mistress, at work. So this is probably a topic for the next OLF edition. Not now, so we'll get back to the point. And that is... Yes, women have many faces, and that's because we don't have a fixed identity as such. We can be so many things, you know. We have a variety of faces which we change almost as often as our clothes, our personalities, depending on a particular situation, a particular need, a particular environment. And some of the faces of women are worshipped, they're revered, whereas some are execrated. I don't want to go into detail about the many faces of women because it's going to come up in our session, and it's also covered in my book, on Shakti, the Divine Feminine. So shameless plug aside, I just want to say that let's talk about the reasons why women have so many faces and stuff. And I feel the main reason is that women change their faces to adapt to a changing society. It's awesome. I think it's indicative of how women are resilient and flexible. They need to be that way in order to survive in a hostile world, right? And another thing is, mostly a woman's many faces are reflections of the society they are in. Their identities are shaped by the place in which they find themselves. For instance, somebody like Mindy Kaling, she would never have been a success in India, whereas somebody like Katrina Kaif or Sunny Leon or Nargis Fakhri, all of them, I doubt they would have made it in Hollywood. And just a few, in the recent past, shall we say, our mothers and grandmothers had to live with a certain reality, and that was that women are expected to be traditional, to moderate their needs, to suit the needs of the man in their life, whether it's the father, son, husband. The woman who was into homemaking, the politically correct term is homemaking now, so the woman who liked to stay home, cook the meals, look after the children, she was revered. Whereas today it's different. Today we have the modern woman who's supposed to be Wonder Woman and Supergirl rolled into one, right? She has to be good at everything. She has to cook and do all that well, and at the same time she probably has to be a CEO, a happening career girl, right? So that's the thing. And the question we should be asking ourselves is this, does that mean that we have been liberated, whether women have been liberated, or is this another form of entrapment? Because I find that for most women, they're not very comfortable with whichever face they have on. You know, the girl who's at home with her children, she's probably thinking, oh my God, all my friends are CEOs of Fortune 500 companies. I haven't really contributed to the coffers of the family. Whereas a successful career woman is also plagued by guilt. She's probably thinking, my friend is a homemaker and she comes home to her husband and her children. I don't have any of that. So I was, when we talk about the guilt that's a constant companion of women, I was wondering where that came from. And it probably springs from a woman's tendency to indict herself for crimes, both real and imagined. For instance, there are lots of cases where victims feel the need to kill themselves, whereas men are less likely to blame themselves, I would say. Even if they behave horribly, they find ways to justify their behavior, but they're not going to excoriate themselves for it. And I think this explains a certain disturbing pattern we have in our society, where women are at the receiving end of punishment, either from men, other women, or from themselves. And I feel that when we read about crimes against women and possible solutions, everyone says we need to change our attitude, right? We need to change how we think and all those things. I agree, but I feel that the change has to come from within each and every woman. We need to stop feeling guilty and we need to stop apologizing for the choices we make. It's only when we find that acceptance, even if it is of a self that is highly flawed, it'll be possible for us to stop fulfilling the burden of expectation and have society mirror our more enlightened outlook. Hopefully, when that happens, we will no longer need Madhuri Dixit in ads telling little boys that they shouldn't make girls cry. We can trust that they will go on to become men who will do the right thing by the women in their lives. And on that note, I would like to ask Chandrahas to say his thoughts on the same subject.
To begin with, I should say that I'm particularly excited to be on a panel like this, because I feel this is what literary festivals and literature should be about. Should be places where who you are is not considered the basis on what you can speak about. And I think there's a particular connection between the theme of our discussion today and Indian fiction or storytelling, which is the one that we all inhabit. And if you look at a lot of the great early Indian novels, they were written by men for historical and social reasons, but a lot of them seem to have like women characters at the center. The very first Indian novel, or the very first great Indian novelist, Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, he wrote Rajmohan's Wife, where it's interesting to look at just those two words as a sort of lens on Indian society, although there's a man's name there, Rajmohan. We never get to hear what his wife's name is until we open the book. The stress of the title falls on the word wife, and it suggests that the agent in the book, the person who's going to orchestrate any, some kind of change of perception, is going to be the woman. I think there's no doubt when I look back at Indian history that no matter how great our ancient times may have been, and we're always being told that we used to be a very great civilization, I don't think things have changed as much for Indian women in the last 1,000 years as they have in the last 50. And so in a peculiar way, all of us, men and women both, find on ourselves the burden of having to deal with the consequences of the shift, a kind of shift in ideas, a shift in social roles, a shift in parenting, a shift in partnership, a shift in marriage, a shift in companionship. The first time I ever came back to Bhubaneswar to give a talk at the university, I found that although everybody was adult in the class and were sitting together to read some extremely complex works of literature, all the boys and girls were sitting in different parts of the class, and at no place did they share any space at all. It's as if that old mentality of the school or of co-ed education had sort of persisted through into adult life. And I think this is a big problem about India today, that it's not just that women have to fight for their rights, it's also that there's so few spaces which are socially mandated where men and women can have genuine conversations with one another. And I feel that literature has always served for a place in Indian society where sometimes what you cannot get from life is what you can get from a book. If you cannot meet an interesting man or an interesting woman in real life, you can sometimes in a book. And in a way, those meetings are just as important. So in some way, I would say that in certain frames, it does not matter whether the human being is a fictional one or a real one. Sometimes the impact on us of people we meet in books is much greater than people we meet in real life. Or the possibilities that women or men offer to each other in books is much bigger than real life. And if you look at an Indian feminist tradition, whether it's Kurtulan Heather, Atiya Hussain, or so many great writers, Indian writers today, Salma from Tamil Nadu, from your state, I think we have some very interesting diagnosis today of exactly this idea that of the many faces of women. But I would disagree with you slightly in thinking of women especially sort of like changeable, or maybe some of it is because of precisely what you say, that circumstances force women to hide and reveal certain sides of each other, of themselves. But to me, it's, I think, one of the main things about our time is that it's become more socially acceptable for women to show greater sides of themselves, a wider range of their own selves to the world. And that is the part of the movement of our time, which is why there's such a great churn in Indian society today. And I think Indian literature is part of which of observing and sometimes commenting upon that churn. I don't know if I'm going to read right away. I think we can all speak for a bit and we'll read later.
He put a very positive spin on that, I think, and that's really cool. And I wanted to, he mentioned how that regarding the many faces of women in literature, it is a lot more heartening than the reality of it. And I would like Anjum to say a few words on that about characters in the literary milieu which are inspiring and serve as an example for both sexes about gender equality.
Well, I think to be a writer and a woman is to constantly worry about being pigeonholed, and not least from literary festivals, where if you're a woman writer, you're going to straight away be bunged into a panel with only women on the assumption that you all write about the same thing. So I'm glad Chandrahas is on this panel. That is a very wonderful corrective. And the pigeonholing happens on different levels. I mean, you pigeonhole yourself as well, I think, sometimes as a woman writer, by writing about characters and about issues that you think are specific to your gender and limiting yourself sometimes. And in my own fiction, I have tried to write about both men and women, neither of whom are really interested in what makes them special as men or women. They're just individuals. And rather than gender, what interests me is contemporary Indian society and the challenges that we all face, irrespective of age or gender, living in 21st century India, particularly living in our cities, and the many sort of contradictions and ambiguities, the fractured relationship that you can have with your environment, the difficulty of knowing what to value, what to hold up as something that you can really unqualifiedly believe in if you're any kind of thinking individual. Those are broadly some of the things that my fiction has addressed. And I think one of the agendas or the brief that a fiction writer gives herself is to not be interested in the generalities. So I really don't want to say anything about the woman or the man because I don't think I can. As a fiction writer, I'm interested in the inner life of a set of characters. And of course, in some sense, they are going to be representative because that's how fiction works, right? You read my character, if she's 25 years old and she's living in the city of Bangalore, she's working the outsourcing industry, you are immediately going to think of her as somehow representative of that section of the population. Namely, the westernized, city-living, liberated, young India, which is earning much more money than their parents did, but is, I think, suffering from some kind of crisis of confidence in what to believe in, which is sometimes expressed as overconfidence. So, of course, there are broader things you can draw from fiction, but I try in my fiction to always return to the particular. And I have written about women characters very, very centrally. I have had female protagonists who carry the story along, but I've also written about men. I'm not going to read right now, but this is the novel that I will read from, which is my latest. And this novel stands or falls on the strength of a 53-year-old woman and her attitude to life, her attitude to art, her relationships. So it is very much the story of a woman, but I would not call it a feminist novel. And having said that, I also realize that I'm standing on the shoulders of women who have written about other women. Chandrahas mentioned some of our leading feminist writers. And the fact that they could write about, first of all, that they could write, that they could publish, that they could enter the public space, I realize that I'm privileged because they have gone before me. And also that they could write about lives that were just not the subject matter of fiction, that they could give that a certain centrality which was missing in fiction. So I realized that I am standing on their shoulders, that I could not dismiss the concerns of gender unless they had come before me and sort of smoothened the path for me. So I think we are at a time now where women are trying to extend what they can do as writers, and that's very, very important. Even while the feminist project remains ongoing, very, very centrally, and there are wonderful writers and wonderful publishers and wonderful editors who still believe that it's important to keep that feminist element central to the writing and the reading of literature. But that does not exhaust the possibilities and should not exhaust the possibilities of what a woman can write. So, those are some of the things that were running through my head when I was told I have to speak about the many faces of women, which I think is the many faces of people in general. Why just women?
I agree completely on that. While we do respect the work of the feminist writers, they've done excellent stuff, I don't think everything has to boil down to our sex. Everything we do in life does not have to boil down to our sex, and I think that's really cool. And I wanted to talk to Shiny about... I'd request Shiny to read a passage from her book. She told me it's going to be about words, and it's fascinating.
Since I never thought of myself, I think I was never brought up by my parents as a girl child, it was difficult for me to think of myself as a female employee or a woman writer. So to amplify what Anjum said, I'll read out something what I've written. And there are female voices in this, but you'll find that by and large, the female voices echo what could be called the human voice. Where do they go? Words no one wants, no one uses anymore. When fathers die and mothers don't remember, all the love words and forever words and promises promised when the mouth moves on to other words, other people. Slips of the tongue and sweet nothings. Baby and bitch. Killer lines and jokes that fall flat. All in the orphanage for words once spoken have to go someplace. 1,000 secrets make the body a bow, but the arrow shot from its mouth is always a word. Small talk, big talk, dirty talk, pillow talk, sleep talk, bilateral talks, baby talk, body talk. Talk to me, all talk, talked into, talked down to, talking shop, let's talk it out. We have ways to make you talk. We need to talk. Folk tales and fairy tales, four-letter words and famous last words. Said behind your face, said behind your back, told to your face, the last text from an ex. And words totally reversible, I do. Because no one does, not really, not for long. Let me tell you a story, the story of my life. That's a whole other story. Tell the story properly, story so far. Cock and bull story, sob story, inside story, cover story, moral of the story, coming of age story, bedtime story. To cut a long story short, what's your story, backstory, story behind the story. Let's get our story straight, his side of the story. Stick to your story, likely story, end of story. Star-crossed Romeo and Juliet words, whistleblower words, Wikipedia words. Chew the fat, shoot the breeze, 19 to the dozen. What you say when asked, was that good for you? Can you keep your word, give your word, go back on your word, take my word, it's your word against mine. Just say the word, in a word, word for word, have a word with him. Word of mouth, lost for words, don't put words in my mouth. Take back your words, away with words, true to his word. Click on this word, run out of words, put in a word for me, word count, word play. Don't breathe a word to anyone. In other words, mark my words, eat your words. Words aren't my thing. Don't call us, we'll call you. That's not what I meant. Even as we speak, no one speaks to me like that, no one. Music to my ears, blowing own trumpet, they are playing our song. Every single password in all the PCs on the planet, all the unsaved files, spam, forwards, chain letters, dear sir, dear ma'am, warm regards, yours sincerely, thanking you. No question of it. Good question. Does that answer your question? Any questions? Out of the question. Can you repeat the question? No questions asked. Begs the question. The question doesn't arise. Ask me no questions. I tell you no lies. 50-pound weakling words that get sand kicked in their face. Hansel and Gretel words that find their way home. Jack-in-the-box words. Words that jump out from behind a sofa screaming, surprise! Lies men tell women to get them into bed. Lies women tell the men they cheat. Did I just say what I just said? I don't know how to say this. As I was saying, I will say this just once. There, I've said it. Goes without saying. Is it something I said? Did you even hear what I said? Don't say it, don't say it, don't. What do you want me to say? Don't make me say it. There's a way of saying it. What will others say? You were saying? Say something, say anything. Pep talk, frankly, bluntly, firmly. And all the pet names you call the men you were in love with. Empty promises, empty boast, empty talk, empty words, empty. The bad, bad poetry of first love. And words that jam your hands on the steering wheel long after the lights turn green. You don't talk to me anymore. Forget I said that. This doesn't change anything. Please hear me out. Where are you going with this? Listen to me. Don't tell me that. That's neither here nor there. It's all coming back to me. Your voice is breaking. People talking without listening. Words are flowing out like it's only words. Suicide notes, message in a bottle. Unrequited words, all dressed up, nowhere to go. Old yellowing letters at the bottom of a trunk. Matrimonial ads in second-hand magazines. Blessings from beggars at rolled-down car windows. A single column on the back page of the last edition of a small-town newspaper. And words you hear between your legs. Fighting words over my dead body. She asked for it. Meaning what exactly? I've heard it all now. Don't make me open my mouth. You don't know how to speak. What you tune out while tenderly eyeing your better half. Speak now or forever hold your tongue. And what can never be taken back in this lifetime. Happy birthday. Words, nuclear holocausts between clenched teeth, heated exchanges in bedrooms, boardrooms, battlefields, a fang bursting its venom right in the mouth, words, small, medium, large, two words running towards each other in slow motion, the growing yes, yes, yes from the room upstairs, a straight road from I love you to it's not you, it's me. Can you keep a secret, me and my big mouth, in this ear and out the other? A white lie, a black tongue, show, don't tell, kiss and tell. The plot thickens, classic, bestseller, to be continued, critically acclaimed, first draft, slush pile, footnotes, first edition, blurbs at the back of books, once upon a time, far, far away, now an e-book with adjustable print. Printed, recall, banned and pulped, read and burn. The unsupportable weight of what has to be said, the absolute no that slams a face shut, the insane axis of Earth crashing through galaxies, breathing its last, clasped hands undone, knuckle by knuckle, bottles after genie's leave, a lyric halved in two. The almost words, virgins on wedding nights, a finger drawing in the vapor on a windowpane, a solar system of syllables, like a prayer prayed to listening gods. An old man holding his wife's hand in dementia, the exile of expression, words yet to grow a soul, the sound of nothing to say, like one mouth kissing, the ungolden silence of silences. Hush, little word, in a shroud of tongue, unclaimed and mortal, no floral casket, only mute hymns, mourners, who tiptoe hands on ears, nothing more ear-splitting than a dying word. Listen.
Thank you, Shiny, for the words. I have a question for you regarding words. And I've noticed that words are used mostly as weapons against women. Again, Chandras, don't get offended, but see, it's easier to hurt a woman with words. And even if you want to insult a man, you're going to call him a son of a bitch, right? Or a bastard, which is actually an insult to his mom.
To your weapon as a woman against a man would be silence, to go totally wordless. And I think if you tune, I mean, of course, anyone, you tune anyone out with silence, there's nothing more hurtful than being forgotten.
Ignored. Thank you, Shaini. And Chandras, this is a quote I read from your book, and I just wanted to talk about, it's a very, very sensitive line, and I really loved it, and I'll read it out for you. It's from Azri the Dwarf. Did I pronounce it right? Yet old fears, when so easily shaken off, they seeped into you and became a part of you. Then again, to not enjoy what was yours, that was almost as bad as not having it at all. I really loved that line because you talked about those old fears seeping into you. And I wanted to hear your thoughts about a climate of fear that's pervaded the country after the crimes against women, right? For instance, there's a certain mistrust between the sexes, no? And it's common, it's too common to hear that men are dogs nowadays. And I wanted to ask you what you felt about that attitude.
I think there's a certain way in which a kind of churning or mistrust could be seen as being positive. It indicates that there's a certain kind of resistance, internal resistance in the society towards old ideas of stability where apparently there was no mistrust and apparently everything was fine. I think that that has had its own dangers. I mean, often here when I go around, people say, oh, the rising divorce rate in India, it just shows that like men and women have just like forgotten what family values are and they don't understand what it means to live together. I really don't think that one can attribute, we are adults for 40 or 50 years in our lives. I really don't think we can attribute motivations and sort of analysis of human behavior to one, two sentences in that way. And actually, I think what is interesting to me, I mean, I was interested to hear Anjum say that when she writes, she thinks of her characters as individuals, not necessarily as men and women first. I have to say, I sort of like work from the opposite point of view. I do write from, when I think about characters, they are men and women first. And I think partly the difference is because I try to write about situations where men and women are interested in one another. And in order to find something out about somebody else, you must first work out who you are and then like sort of extrapolate from that. So I'm very interested in these processes where sort of men and women watch each other and the ways in which, despite the apparent problems that lie not just between the obvious differences of biology and but also those of culture, the ones that you point out, the fact that there's a history of violence. In fact, there's a chapter in my new book where there's a woman character who's a professor of English literature who suggests that maybe we should, to begin with, we should drop the words men and man, woman altogether and begin with two new words, because the history of man-woman conflict is in some way embedded in these words. And we have to sort of, to make a new beginning, maybe we need to find new words for who we are. So I would not sort of, to me, like, it's more interesting to see what kinds of, for instance, against this obvious background of conflict and male chauvinism and violence that you describe, to me, for instance, it's very interesting to watch a boy and a girl who are 18 sort of fall in love with one another and have that sort of, like, automatic sort of innocence and reciprocity, then disturbed by a sense of, by their families, that this is not the right time to fall in love, that you should fall in love. To fall in love itself is a crime, that you should, like, marry whom you want. So it's clear to me that the violence is not just about single people, it's about structures in a society. I wondered if I could just take this chance, like, to read a bit.
Yes, please, hoping you would. You mentioned your new book and that very interesting English professor.
Okay, and then I will not say any more, and it's all up to you. I'll listen to the three of you. I think one of the things that interests me is in my generation, our generation, is the freedom to love that men and women have. And I think in at least this much is true, that our generation has done more to change this notion than anyone, recent one before us, because we have that much more sense of, like, living in a cosmopolitan world where sometimes we wonder whether if you make a choice, a free choice, as an adult, then why should anybody else want to stop that? And as part of the freedom to love, I'm also interested in the idea of the freedom to love for a second time. You know, that often we are very different when we are 22 to who we are 35 or 40. So in my new book, Clouds, is about this 41-year-old man who is divorced and feels that, in a way, he's kind of relieved because that marriage wasn't working out. But then he finds that isn't really anybody new. There isn't a place in Indian society to meet someone new, to share space with. It's almost like it's all left up to chance or not at all. And he decides that he's going to leave India completely because he just doesn't feel that in this entire country of a billion, there's someone there for him. And in the week before he leaves, he suddenly runs into somebody who lives in America and is just visiting India. So the book is partly about a swift romance in India. And as part of the story, the two of them go on a date together. And they go on a date. They're both Parsi, so they go on this date. There's a big function. You must know Udwada is a sacred place for the Parsi community. So they go on this date, on this drive together to Udwada. And Farhad, who's the protagonist of the book, is very pleased that after Indian women ignoring him for 4 or 5 years continuously, an American girl who's also part Indian has come in and thinks he's so wonderful. It's clearly like he feels that here's someone who's really seen my worth. And he wants very much also to return the sentiment to this woman who has, like, treated him so well. So they're on this drive together. And it turns out that it's not just Farhad that this girl is interested in. There's another Indian man whom she really likes. "I'm looking forward to visiting the fire temple after so many years, for sure," said Zara. "But Farhad, I must tell you, what I'm looking forward the most is the chief speaker of today's function." "And who might that be?" I said. "The year is 2011. Narendra Modi, the chief minister of Gujarat," said Zara. "It said so in the paper this morning." "What? Doomsday is upon us. How could they have invited a non-Parsi to lead the function?" I asked. "Oh, Farhad, don't be so narrow-minded," said Zara. "He's the chief minister of the state after all. And let's not forget, one of the most powerful men in this country. If he's on our side, it's great for us. Everywhere else, Indians are longing for someone like him to come and straighten out their lives, to change the image that people around the world have of us Indians. Here's a man who could become Prime Minister of India in 2014. And today we get to see him right in front of us, in the flesh, speaking about Parsi culture, Parsi dreams. Here's a man who doesn't exactly have the best record when it comes to minorities, wouldn't you say?" I asked, with the delicacy that is my hallmark. "Oh, Farhad," said Zara, "all those riots and stuff from 10 years ago. Guy, how long can you be stuck in the past? If all those crazy Gujarati people run around intent on killing one another, how's a single man to stop them without killing a few as well? Let's look at the big picture too, else we are being as narrow-minded as the person we accuse of being the same. Roads, electricity, infrastructure, jobs, business development, no corruption. These aren't things for majorities and minorities. They're the tide that lifts all the fish, or no, all the boats, or whatever it is. If you keep arguing about all these things, when will we ever get anything done? What this country needs for a while is a dictator, and then we can go back to being a democracy. I've been doing a lot of reading up on this man. He's the one for the future. There's no question about it. I don't know what it is with you girls, said Zara's uncle from the back seat. You're all in love with him. It's time that the vote for women was taken back. What for? Said Zara. Women like the look of a man who knows what he wants and sets out to get it. And it's kind of sexy that sometimes he talks about his chest size. Why should only women have numbered chests? If we are never perfect unless we have a 36-inch chest, we'd like a man with a 56-inch one. But let's put it this way. I might have some business with Mr. Modi, just like you did. What? Said Uncle. My niece and Mr. Modi as business partners? Think about it, said Zara. Here I am, Zara Irani, a few months away from putting all my life savings into this yoga school. And he's the one prominent politician who's really and publicly into yoga, which everyone never talks about, just because they think it has some link to right-wing politics. Do you know, last year, when he had a brainstorming camp for all the bureaucrats in the state, he made them all wake up in the morning at 5 o'clock and do yoga with him? No fussing over whether it was Hindu or non-Hindu or all that nonsense that makes us all live in mental ghettos. No one was allowed to miss it. Either you do yoga or you go back home and probably you miss your next promotion. Someone in my yoga group forwarded me pictures of the camp on email. Everyone around Mr. Modi, poor things, looked like they had concrete in their limbs and would rather be asleep in their beds. But he was wearing a black tracksuit and sneakers and doing all these awesome poses and really looking kind of sexy. Uncle, if I could just find a way of getting through to him today and telling him about my yoga school in San Francisco, maybe, who knows, he'd agree to become a brand ambassador. I know that he wants to reach out to America, and he must have felt so terrible when the states wouldn't give him a visa. Even just a personal message from his office for my website would just be so cool. I could send it out to a local press, and it would make for such a great PR push. And that way, I'll be able to sweep up all the Indians in San Francisco when my business is new, and then all their friends, and then friends of friends who wouldn't be Indian, and then the whole world's at my door. And then in turn, maybe we could raise some funds for 2014. After all, he'll need cash if he wants to run for prime minister in the next elections. See, it's win-win on both sides. So maybe just Anuja to channel like your title of your book, which I hope you will read from. This is kind of, I was trying to write about an aspect of Shakti in India today.
Actually, it's related, you know. Even I chose a passage which is based on his, you know, because I didn't, it's so humorous. And there's a saying which says that no matter what the question is, the answer is chocolate. But I think Chandra has proved no matter what the question is, perhaps the answer is humor. And so, which is why I chose a humorous portion from this book. And on Shakti, it happens after the great battle with the buffalo demon Mahishasura. And what actually happens is kind of different from what's commonly portrayed, where Durga rides to battle on a lion with 1,000 limbs and all those weapons. And the goddess is kind of annoyed that people persist in thinking that way about the great battle that happened. Shakti viewed the rivalry with extreme annoyance and confided her feelings to Shiva and Vishnu. It is to be wondered if they will remember the actual lesson to be learned here. I'm getting the bad feeling that the devas and humans alike will get carried away with the elaborate rituals they have devised so lovingly in Durga's honor and devote their lives to them, conveniently ignoring the rest of the factors that led to the spectacular rise and fall of Mahisha. Why do they feel the need for such a rigidly structured approach, which is the surest way to trap themselves in ignorance forever? If they are not careful, then all too soon they'll blunder their way into yet another end of the three worlds crisis. And I'll be bemoaning the fact that no matter how many valuable lessons are offered by the past, those in the present will choose to bypass them, almost guaranteeing a retribution-filled future for themselves. How will your children learn what you want them to when you are unapologetically intransigent and insist on operating in great secrecy, deliberately making them play a complicated game of hide and seek with the truth? Vishnu asked her. It is because I want them to care enough about the things worth learning, to devote more of themselves towards unearthing it, Shakti snapped at him. If everything were to be unmasked for their viewing pleasure in plain sight, they would still shut their eyes, ignoring its worth, and discard it like trash. You are right, of course, Shiva agreed. All the more reason for you to come away with me and forget about the humans for the foreseeable future. It is too bad you can't make them study their lessons at Spear Point. They are all annoying creatures. But the good news is that you have earned us all a respite from them. It will be a while before we are called upon to bail them out from whatever life-threatening situation they have got themselves into. Besides, you should be admiring that attractive statue they have consecrated to the goddess Durga. I think Vishnu will agree with me that it far surpasses the original in terms of beauty. Vishnu was happy to go along. The Vishwakarma certainly knew what he was doing. The original may be the most beauteous thing in the three worlds, but that statue is something else and entirely lifelike. I could spend all my time gazing at the bounties of that bosom and the abundance of that derriere. Don't even get me started on those remarkable curves that were made to be caressed. No wonder the three worlds are filled to overflowing with sexist swine, Shakti responded bitingly, though she had promised herself that she would not rise to the bait. The shocking conduct of the foremost of the gods is all they have by way of example, so it is hardly surprising that they objectify their women in that despicable way. You would think that a good day's work would have earned me some respect as opposed to this sort of boorish conduct. Perhaps it is high time the two of you were taught a lesson at Spearpoint. Shakti could have gone on, but she was determined to preserve her dignity while the preserver and destroyer clutched their stomachs and howled with laughter. In some ways, duplicate Durga is superior to the real Shakti, don't you think, Vishnu? Shiva managed between uncontrollable paroxysms of glee. She speaks the beautiful language of silence, which is so soothing to the ears, unlike the spitfire here, whose voice gets so shrill when annoyed. Twasta's labor of love won't be getting into hissy fits or be subject to uncontrollable mood swings either. Stop it, Shiva. Your behavior is truly reprehensible, Vishnu chided in a high-pitched, affected tone, which only proves that he's a lousy mimic, Shakti thought irritably. She expects nothing but respect from us, and we owe it to her, Vishnu continued his banter. We can take it in turns to bathe her in milk and honey. You get some flowers while I anoint her with perfumes. Incense is irksome to her nostrils, but it would not do for us to ignore the proper procedures for her worship. Once the ritual is complete, we will sing songs praising her until the birds drop out of the skies in protest, and then she'll forgive us for our insufferable conduct and love us again. Love you too, don't count on it, Shakti replied. Thank you. Anjum, why don't you read your extract?
So I'm going to read a little bit about Kayanath, who, like I said, is a woman in her early 50s. So even though she does not belong necessarily to the generation that has the freedom to love, I did want to give her the freedom to love. She has had relationships in the past, she has divorced, and when the novel starts, she is meeting again after a gap of 15 years, young man that she knew in the previous millennium. And this novel is in many ways about art. It's about contemporary art. And this young man who is returning to the city of Bangalore and who she's going to meet after such a long time is an artist who's sort of returning in glory because he went away as an anonymous young graphic designer, and he's returning as this world-famous, much celebrated, very rich young artist. I am not, however, going to read the bit to do without art because I realize that the kind of the tenor of the discussion since this morning has been about the changes in India, 1991, pre-globalization, post-globalization India. So I thought I'd read a chapter a little bit about money. And when I say that Kayanath has the freedom to love, it is a story about love, but it is not only a story about love. It is also a story about money, the new India within quotes, crime. It's a story about if you belong to a generation where your parents believed in the Nehruvian values and you have friends who are younger and belong to the so-called MTV generation and have, on the face of it, a greater sense of confidence, then where do you fit in this new milieu? That was the reason that she is the age that she is and why I thought it could be very interesting to write a whole novel seen from the point of view of someone whose own father was a believer in the Nehruvian values, was a public works department engineer, and she's still mourning the death of her father. So I wanted to personalize this question. What if your own father was a Nehruvian? This is not an abstract concern, right? At the same time, you have friends, like the young artist I mentioned, who has taken wonderful advantage of the opportunities that the New India provides. So that's a little bit of the background. Kayanath is not an artist herself. She has friends who are artists, who are art critics, who are art collectors. So she belongs in some ways to this universe of art. And she herself, again, is to my mind, a somewhat old-fashioned thing. She's a rasika. She believes that the only thing she needs to sustain herself is to be a lover of art. And it doesn't make her any money. So as a result, she's not very well off. She's always in a position where she doesn't quite know where she's going to get. She realizes that she's too middle class to ever be without a roof over her head or without a meal. But all the same, she's not really well to do. And she has this friend called Sara Mir, who's old money. She's an art collector and she has a lot of inherited wealth. So this is from a chapter called Money. Money. Something had been happening since the turn of the century to render everyone well off except Kayanath, let alone the elderly uncles and aunties still clinging to their bungalows and their club memberships, and the rich young hipsters with everything in their pockets. Even the carefree drifters of her own generation, who seemed once to have bypassed the idea of money by having regular careers and raising regular kids, or living with their parents till they were 45 and adapting themselves without loss of soul to any hack job, had proved once the new century dawned not to be so retiring after all. Kayanath discovered this late. It was as if they'd all just been waiting for the pear soap and Italian pasta to hit the shelves before they disowned their alleged poverty, grinning sheepishly as they abandoned the Swadeshi delights of their youth, the polka-dotted nylon saris, the low-roofed Fiat cars, the striped yellow packs of glucose biscuits, the synthetic orange juices, the bottles of royal blue Chelpark ink with which one filled fountain pens to write letters to faraway friends, and with which friends fill their pens to write back. How is it that everyone except Kayanath had been lifted to safe ground by the deluge? There hadn't been time to investigate. She'd spent most of her energy just keeping her head above the water. Kayanath had done seemingly everything. She'd taken on freelance writing, edited academic tomes, taught school children, worked for a ridiculous magazine. After 20 years of doing this shit, there was nothing to show for it, of course, but hadn't that been the point once, that you weren't supposed to care? Once, it didn't matter what you did as long as you weren't showy. Now, it no longer mattered what you did as long as you were. Kayanath had tried to preserve her dignity, but it wasn't any good. Back in the previous century, when she and Baban were friends, Bangalore had seemed innocent of pelf. No tales of software entrepreneurs making it big, no luxury apartments calling out from the hoardings, no sedans gliding down every second street. Then he left town, and the roar of this material world grew louder around Kayanath. She had resorted to people like Sathi, for whom wealth was a form of crime, and Sara, who was able to remain indifferent to money via money. Sara came from a rich Kashmiri family that had for generations been into carpet manufacture. Both her grandfathers, her father, her brothers, her uncles, her male cousins, all the men in her single-minded family were into carpets. Sara's rebellion from the carpet world took the form of marriage to a non-carpet man. Her husband, Sardar Rai, was some kind of don of car dealerships, having set up several across the country. To Kayanath, the difference between cars and carpets didn't seem that remarkable, but Sara's father had apparently been furious. She'd not only married outside the extended family, but chosen a man who wasn't into carpets. Let alone carpets, he wasn't even Kashmiri. And forget not being Kashmiri, he wasn't even Muslim. The rebellion, however, turned out to be not much more than a frisson. A reunion had been deftly negotiated by a sympathetic aunt, and Sarah was accepted back into the carpet fold. She treated her relatives with amused indifference ever since, but it did not hurt that she came into a handsome inheritance in the shape of an old bungalow when her parents passed away. At some point in her marriage, Sarah decided that she'd had enough of the workaholic Sardar, who apparently conducted business negotiations even in his sleep, and who adored Sarah but always put his cars first. She trained her maid to pack the right shirts for his business trips and give him breakfast on time. When they actually met, which was two or three times a week, Sarah and her husband behaved towards each other with the friendliness of colleagues working in different departments of a mammoth enterprise, politely curious about the goings-on in each other's wings, but aware that to them it made no difference. Sarah wasn't really bothered about how the money was made as long as she was given enough of it, and her husband really didn't care what she did with her time as long as she stayed his. Sarah was the first person Kainath had befriended from that world in which you spent money you hadn't earned. She had grown interested in how the mind of the rich worked, not just the moral side of it. Should you buy Versace when people toiled in hardship knotting carpets so you could buy Versace, but the psychological. Kainath, who had spent so long trying to render money irrelevant and suffered from her failure to do so, was fascinated by Sarah's composure. She had realized over time that because Sarah's wealth was hereditary, this composure was genetic. There was no way that Kainath could aspire to it.
Thank you, Anjum. I would like to open the floor for questions, if there are any.
I meant to ask if, I mean, we all read a lot of books. I wonder if we could do, if you ever did a blindfold test and like start reading from like, the first page, we'd be able to tell if it was a male or a female writer, always.
Of course not. I don't think so. I mean, if that was the case, then we wouldn't have novels like Madame Bovary, and we wouldn't have novels like, I don't know, Tess, or there's a wonderful Israeli novelist called Amos Oz who has, to my mind, written the best book on the inner life of a woman, My Michael. So, I mean, that's a test of a writer that you can transcend everything, not just your gender.
Tiny, what about you? If you were blindfolded, you think?
No, I know that when we need to talk about Kevin, there's a book by Lionel Shriver, which had come out, and a lot of people read it thinking it was written by a man, and they praised it a lot. You know, they probably would not have come up with those compliments if they knew that it was not written by a man.
Are there any questions? No?
Yeah, please don't worry, it's a very mild question. What I wanted to ask is, we are talking about the many faces of women and many faces of women in literature. So I just wanted to know that, the modern fiction in English, Indian fiction in English, are there many faces of women in India which are not represented at all? We talk about the urban educated, we do talk about maybe the small town girl who's made it to the, but we talk about different women in different walks of life, But are we able to talk, are we able to represent the woman, the other faces of the Indian woman? I'm talking about the woman in the village laborer. We are talking about, are there many faces of women or many sides of women, many types of women who are silent in literature, in at least English, Indian English fiction? That's my question.
Well, it's certainly true that a lot of us who write fiction in English write about characters from our class, both men and women. But I think an interesting corrective to that is translation into English, which to my mind also becomes part of the genre of English literature in India. I don't see it as productive to necessarily make such a big distinction between what is originally written in English and what is translated, because as a writer, all of that feeds into, and as a reader, all of that feeds into influences. And I'm thinking, for instance, of this wonderful book that was published by Zuban, the publisher Zuban, which was the diary of a domestic worker, a domestic servant, Baby Haldar, which became a huge hit internationally and was translated into several European languages. And that was originally written in Hindi, I think, or Bengali. I'm not sure which one. So that is part of the landscape. And certainly these are voices, or the fiction of Mahashweta Devi, right, which has now been wonderfully translated and available. And that is very different from the typical middle class English language fiction. And I think you also, to enlarge the genre, should look at wonderful narrative nonfiction being written in English. And again, some of that looks at many faces of women. I'm thinking, for instance, of Sonia Falero's work. Sonia Falero's Beautiful Thing, which is the story of a sex worker in Bombay. A bar dancer in Bombay. And she's recently written about the story of a woman, Adi Farsi woman, who was raped in West Bengal. So certainly into English, I think if you look for them, all these other voices do come in. All these other faces do come in.
Hello. In depicting women, do you have any grudge against men writers? I mean to say, any complaint against men writers?
Shiny, you answer.
I feel sometimes you're pleasantly reminded you're a woman when you're called to a panel like this with a topic like this. And sometimes you're unpleasantly reminded that you're a woman, because most of the time you're not thinking, I'm a woman, I'm a man. You know, you're just getting on with your life. But I remember once in Bombay, a friend of mine was supposed to meet me, and she's quite tall, so I saw her from far. And we waved at each other, and we were coming towards each other. And there was this guy whom I hadn't even seen. His expression never changed. And he came, and then, you know, his elbow came up, and he hit me. And I stopped, and I looked, but he had gone far away. And I thought, oh my God, he did this because, you know, I'm not a man. But also, right at that moment, I was wondering, what is he? He's a magician. He's a mathematician. He's a Superman. Because look at the way he judged the distance. If he had done it a second early, I wouldn't have known. Or a second later, he wouldn't have been happy. But he did it so correctly, and his expression never changed. I think that all that takes a lot of thinking, you know.
Hello. This is the question for the panel for discussion. The discussion which you are having is that the many faces of women. But I don't think that there are also many faces of men also. In the sense, they are also cooking, they are also taking care of the child, and blah, blah, blah. So I would like to make it clear. So your discussion is that which you are having is certainly going injustice to against the men.
No, but I said that at the beginning. No, I addressed that at the beginning. I said that this is not a condition exclusive to women, because men, we are aware that men have many more faces than they reveal to us. And we did say that it's a topic. We are suggesting that as a topic for the TNIE team to cover in the next edition of OLF. So we'll have the many faces of men with three male writers and maybe one female writer, just for a change.
My question is to Ms. Chandramouli. I would like to know the kind of what kind of research you do before writing a mythological fiction.
At the beginning of this book, there's an author's note where I have addressed that question, because people always ask me about the research I have done for my books, and it is extensive, yes. But the thing is, they most want to know which parts of it are fact and which parts are fiction. And I don't have a proper answer for that, because my work is faction. It's partly fact, it's partly fiction, and even I am not sure where one ends and where the other begins, and I'm not at all curious to find out. So I'd suggest you do the same, and you can take whatever you want from my books. That's fine.
Hello.
Yes, but since you are speaking now, why don't you ask a question now? They will give you one.
Thank you. I hope it is a pityness and kindness. Very good after. To all the dignitaries on the desk and colleagues, participants and students of the desk. In this session, I would like to raise the question. In India, there's a case study I would like to produce. Girl loves naturally the boy. They loved. They got married. After some times, they have passed through a cosmopolitan phases and more liberated, so-called now, get divorced. So now, in which direction you like to write whatever you write to bring this type of love in the right direction, whereas the Westerners follows India because the people's husband and wife remaining for a long time. So this is my question. I have already told in which way the writers, authors and poets direct the existing society to be in the frame, whereas the Westerners are thronging, following us, because Indians are always great, they are living always together. Thank you.
This has to be the last question as well. I can understand what it was, though. Anything that...
I have a question here, if that's fine.
We will have to end this. You'll have to take the questions off the dais. I'm not able to actually find out who's asking where.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll have to take the questions off the dais now. All right, thank you so much. Sorry? No, there was somebody who asked. You have to stop us. He asked to move to the off the dais, yes.
There's a question there.
Anjum, actually I have a question for you specifically. Other panelists are also free to answer, of course. Which is that the topic for the discussion for this panel, I mean, would it change substantively if the question is turned into that of a genre, of dealing with specific genres? Like, can we discuss this topic for literature, quote-unquote, in general, or because you're a writer who have actually practiced across genres and forms, so will the question change, and will we get different answers?
So, I haven't fully got your question. Are you saying that everything that I've said, would it change if the panel was about genre rather than gender?
No. I'm saying, for example, a lot of the discussions
are
about...
Could you be a little louder? It's,
yeah, you
your voice is not audible.
A lot of the discussion that has happened is about fiction, right? What if we ask the question about poetry? What if we ask the question about theater, drama, please? So will the questions and the answers change substantively?
Oh, if we were not talking about fiction?
Yeah.
Ah, okay. I think they would substantially be the same if we were talking about any creative expression. whether it was poetry or theater, or fiction, or even creative nonfiction. I mean, why should Sonia? I mentioned Sonia Filera writing this book about a bar dancer, but it could have been a man. So no, I don't think so. I think many of these things that we've discussed are to do with larger societal assumptions about certain things, and where we as creative people, with hopefully more nuanced positions, where we come in. So I think it would apply across the board with regard to poetry and theater as well.
All right, thank you. Thank you to all our panelists. May I now request the editorial director of the New Indian Express, Mr. Prabhu Chawla, to please present mementos to our esteemed panelists before we move on to the next session. Just a sec. Yeah, okay. That had to be an urgent point. So, thank you, everyone.